Disclaimer: the following analysis is based on preliminary data and limited visual observation, so it may not be 100% accurate. Bear this in mind, please. Having said that, here are all four MSI motherboards from the lowest to the highest tier. The X670 Pro-P is an 8-layer ATX board with 8+8 12-volt pins and a power design advertised as Duet Rail 14+2+1. This means that an unknown PWM controller drives 7 V-core phases with 2 parallel power stages for each one, and maybe also the 2 SoC and 1 miscellaneous phases. Regrettably, I don't know the specs of the power stages, apart from the fact that the V-core ones are rated for 80 Ampere. Anyway, they are cooled, together with the chokes, by a finless heatsink with 7 watts per meter Kelvin thermal pads, but a backplate is missing. Moving on to the expansion slots. There are 1 PCIe 3x1 and 3 PCIe 4 of the same size, but wired to 16, 4 and 2 lanes respectively. Furthermore, the second and fourth slots are not reinforced, just like the 4 DDR5 ones. As for storage, while 3 M.2 PCIe 4 sockets are in the open air, under the sole heatsink we'll find the Gen 5 one, and on the right side, 6 SATA ports. Now the internal headers: 7 fan plus 1 pump, 4 RGB, 2 of which addressable, 2 USB 2, 2 USB 3.2 Gen 1, and 1 USB 3.2 Gen 2. The board also has debug LEDs, but sadly, no debug code display. Lastly, let's have a look at the back panel, devoid of its shield. BIOS flashback button, 1 HDMI 2.1, 1 DisplayPort 1.4, 4 USB 3.2 Gen 1, 3 USB 3.2 Gen 2, of which 1 Type-C with TP 1.4 support, and 1 USB 3.2 Gen 2x2 Type-C. The LAN options include wireless 6E plus Bluetooth 5.2 offered by a MediaTek/AMD RZ616 module and wired 2.5 gigabit per second by a Realtek RTL8125BG chip. This last vendor also provides the ALC48 codec that runs the 6 audio ports. Next comes the X670E Carbon. Compared to the Pro-P, the V-core phases of this model are now 2 more, and its power stages are upgraded from 80 to 90 Ampere. Moreover, whereas yes, it loses 4 USB 3.2 Gen 1 backports, the PCIe 3x1 slot, 1 fan and 1 RGB headers, it gains a lot: 4 additional USB 3.2 Gen 2, 2 USB 2, clear CMOS and programmable buttons, and the debug code display. But the most significant improvements definitely concern PCIe. An M.2 PCIe 4 socket and 2 PCIe 4 slots are now upgraded to Gen 5, with these latter wired to 16 and 8 lanes. Finally, the last PCIe 4 doubles its bandwidth, and all M.2 sockets are covered by heatsinks. Then, there's the X670E Ace. Any ATX board with 2 extra V-core phases, a fully thinned VRM heatsink, a full cover backplate, and several other upgrades over the Carbon. First of all, the PCIe 4x4 is now a reinforced Gen 5, and one more M.2 PCIe 5 socket is offered by an external card, equipped with an heatsink plus fan. I've said one more, even though this card clearly has 2, because one of the 2 former M.2 PCIe 5 sockets on board is downgraded to Gen 4, as on the Pro-P. Other additions include 1 pump and 1 ARGB headers, 1 front USB 3.2 Gen 2x2 Type-C with 60 watts power delivery, and NESS9280AQ DAC/HPA, in combo with a slightly different codec. Speaking of its back panel, the Ace trades two USB 2 for 3.2 Gen 2, the HDMI and DP ports for another USB 3.2 Gen 2 by 2 Type-C, and the 2.5G Realtek LAN for a 10 gigabit per second Marvel AQC113 controller. Lastly, the X670
Godlike,
a 10-layer flagship that, in terms of power delivery, doesn't seem to be so much different from its little sister. It only gets one extra V-core phase, and its power stages are now rated for 105 Ampere. As far as features are concerned, here too the difference appears to be marginal. It drops fins on half of its VRM heatsink and two back USB 3.2 Gen 2, one of which Type-C with DP 1.4 support, but in turn gains one fan header, two SATA ports, one 2.5 gigabit per second Intel i225V, and a gimmick too. An external 4.5-inch IPS touchscreen display showing various system information and more. Yet, the Godlike has an hidden quality that may be essential for some overclockers. It supports NVIDIA SLI. To my knowledge, so far, this is the only AM5 board with an SLI license. Fine, but what do I subjectively think of the MSI lineup? I cannot deny that my own view is strongly affected by the official prices. The MEG series is too damn expensive, especially the flagship, whose sole purpose is to be a halo product. So that leaves only the Pro-P and Carbon. However, as I did with Gigabyte Mobos in my previous video, I would exclude all those that have no PCIe 5 slots and the debug code display, namely the Pro-P. I'm well aware that no current VGA takes advantage of PCIe 5, but AM5 will be supported until at least 2025, and a motherboard can and should surely last this long. In a 3-5 years' time, there will possibly be graphics cards that make use of it. If not, those Gen 5 lanes would still be useful for fast storage. Hence, in my opinion, the Carbon wins. This would be my reasoning if I really needed an X670/E board, but I do not. A B650/E would be way more suitable for me. If you prefer to compare these MOBOs yourself, you will find a spreadsheet in the video description that includes the other vendors as well. Because this is still a work in progress, please let me know if you find any mistakes. Next Monday, I'm gonna show you the ASRock lineup, so don't forget to subscribe. Fare you well for now.